You ever have a friend, a white friend, who listens to rap and says the N-word when the lyrics come up? He has one black friend who he doesn't really know super well. If he's an American, maybe he votes Democrat if he can be bothered to vote at all, but occasionally he just says insensitive shit as it relates to race, but frames it as respect and admiration and cannot be convinced otherwise? Yeah, we all have. And if you haven't, that friend might be you. The fact is that the reason this archetype of a real person seems so familiar is because this is not an individual matter. It's a sociological matter, meaning it's a system of interaction that has been developed over time and exists in an invisible, ubiquitous way in society. It's a thing. And we see it in Jordan Peele's 2017 film Get Out. In the film, Chris is about to meet his girlfriend's parents. Rose comes from an affluent family with black servants, and the family seems corny but harmless at first. Not people who would chase off a black man dating their daughter with a shotgun, right? Except their admiration, however genuine they believe it to be, is actually sinister. They want to use Chris's body, and this is where the absurdist horror stuff comes in, as a vessel for an aging white man who wants a mind transplant. This family just does this all the time. The estate reminds the audience of a southern plantation. A black servant pours iced tea for the family and is shooed away when she makes a small mistake. Some of the costumes look older, the bingo game as an auction, and so forth. Chris saves himself through cotton, which is almost certainly a historical reference to slavery. This gives us a subtle impression that society's past will always have an impact on the present. It is impossible to disassociate America's history of slavery, segregation, and other historical instances of extreme racism because the economic and social effects are still being felt today. By doing this, the film exposes the little white lie about racism, that it's over, that we live in a post-racial society. This is a myth. It's a myth that following the civil rights movement of the 1950s and 1960s, people of color are technically protected under the law as much as white people, and that solved everything. Except it didn't. In law, there is a difference between something that is de jure and de facto. De jure means that a law is enforced, it's on the books, it's law, it's totally legal. De facto means that it operates in practice even if it's not on the books. For example, following the Civil Rights Act, segregation was illegal in the de jure sense, but not de facto. The truth is that America has done little to desegregate neighborhoods, which is tied to private prejudice, personal choices, realtor discrimination, or income differences that make the predominantly white suburbs unaffordable to most African Americans. And here's the thing. If neighborhoods are segregated by private activity, we can do little about it. In the film, Dean says that he loves his house and that he has complete privacy out here. He does not remark on the privileges granted to him by de facto segregation. He mentions how he voted for Barack Obama twice, but he says nothing of actual politics or substance. His boast is not special. Men like Dean talk a big game about how much things have changed while ignoring all the ways it hasn't. Not to mention, he benefits from them. We get a lot of foreshadowing about the Armitage family's true intentions. Chris looks at the deer they hit with sympathy, connecting the two, and then when he is captured like an animal as well, he sees a deer head above the television. Missy's dainty, genteel teacup is a symbol of the mask of civility, hiding true intentions. Dean says there is black mold in the basement, and then we learn black bodies are used as molds for white minds. So, classic movie foreshadowing and symbolism, yes, but if you know the history of de facto racial attitudes in society, your spidey sense should already be going off, pretty much right after meeting the superficially polite white mother and father. When Jim tells Chris that he wants to take his eyes, this makes narrative sense because Jim is blind and wants to see again, but figuratively, Jim wants to take Chris's identity, who he is. See, Chris's identity is wrapped up in his eye. He is a photographer, both professionally and as a piece of how he sees himself. His identity, it's his. But Jim wants to take that away from him. He wants it for himself. Professionally, Jim wants Chris's eye to appropriate his photography as his own. Jim is an art dealer who can't actually see the art. Even before then, Jim says that he never really had the talent, the eye, for creating art. Jim literally wants his eyes, but he figuratively wants his eye. And that brings us to the core of the movie. Remember your white friend who doesn't really get it? Well, Get Out is not so much about overt, unambiguous, loud, and in-your-face racism like you will see at a KKK march or a neo-Nazi rally or Twitter, but the kind of smug, moderate liberal white mindset that is widespread. Not the fringe elements, but the mainstream. The fringe can be fought, can be pushed aside. The mainstream is in the air. People like Dean and Missy are not interested in learning about systemic racism, about sociological functions of racism, about obvious disadvantages and white privilege. White privilege is an inherent advantage possessed by a white person in a majority white society. People who oppose the existence of white privilege like to pretend it's something that it's not. So to clear up that myth, white privilege does not mean that if you are white, your life is definitely going to be great. It only means that you will not face specific societal challenges and hardships that people of color face. Hardships exist in everyone's life, but specific hardships for the majority do not exist as a result of being in the majority, whereas specific hardships do exist as a result of being in the minority. And no, someone referencing your privilege is not a hardship. White privilege also does not mean every white person in a white majority country is actively and purposefully oppressing people of color, but it does mean every white person passively benefits from white privilege. Some white people get so angry when bringing up the topic of white privilege, but you know what? Avoiding an uncomfortable topic is something the people at the party in Get Out do, and we're not going to be like them, right? They are too attached to the status quo to upset the apple cart. Those who benefit from inequality, even those with otherwise good intentions, can't turn down the rewards of said inequality. And because this inequality is the status quo and therefore invisible, it goes unquestioned, leading to obliviousness. The people at the garden party have the gall to ask Chris whether he believes being black in America gives him greater privileges, ignoring actual de facto segregation, documented police prejudice against people of color, housing discrimination, and yes, this still exists today, regardless of it being legally prohibited, and so many other things. To the people at the party, they can't imagine this, and they don't actually want to. They want to quite literally push out black consciousness. They are living lives of white fragility, meaning discomfort or outright defensiveness when a white person is confronted with information about racial inequality or injustice. Basically, white fragility is the byproduct of white people living in social environments that insulate themselves from stress related to race. This increases their comfort, but lowers their tolerance for anything resembling racial pressure. Logan, an old white man living inside a black man's body, says that his African-American experience has been quite agreeable. This is the cluelessness shown in its extreme. He has no idea, even after living in the skin of an actual black man. People like those at the party might self-identify as being left of center, but you won't find them at any Black Lives Matter rallies or solidarity with Charlottesville marches. You won't see them campaign for or contribute to leftist politicians. Only neoliberal politicians who have their financial interests at heart. They reference Tiger Woods as if this is meant to impress Chris. They compliment him by talking about his genetic makeup. These are microaggressions, but they add up to condescension and reveal that they do not see Chris as a person so much as a representative of his race, even as a product. Get Out has us look at how black culture can be co-opted by the white majority. Someone in the garden party says black is in fashion. When Chris asks Jim why black people are used for the mind transplant procedure, Jim doesn't give a classic hateful answer, like saying he doesn't think black lives are worth anything. No, he says that people want to be cooler, a reference to this commodification of black culture by white society. The auction harkens back to the era of slavery in America, but in Get Out, we see that blackness is commodified and sold in different ways. Get Out shines a light on this topic, dismisses white fragility, confronts white privilege, and debunks the idea of a post-racial society. Writer-director Jordan Peele has remarked, "It is a very personal movie and based on my experiences as an African American, especially when I am in a situation where I feel like an outsider. A lot of this takes place in a party where a lot of elderly white guests approach the main character and try to connect directly with what they think is blackness. After a while, it adds up to something important. It adds up to the fact that we cannot be in a post-race world because I am being approached with my blackness first and foremost. We never fully understand how the Armitages justify their kidnappings. They are too boring to be evil in the most hyperbolic sense of that word. They're actually worse. The Armitages and the white people at the party function as a metaphor for white racism. It's a fully established, inherited practice that is so rote that it is as banal and mundane as the party. Kidnapping and violating black bodies is so ingrained in their culture that it's normal to them. The movie's absurdist allegory aside, Get Out is not a movie about lynch mobs. It's about something more pernicious: normalization of racism. Hi everyone, if you like what I do, please click on the orange Patreon link below. That's how this show happens. It's also the only way to request an episode. Also, please like, share, subscribe, and click on the notification bell so that you never miss an episode. I'll see you next week.